Good evening, everybody. Welcome to the Pits of Motor Chaos. Your host Dave, and I got on the line with me, Lyle Greenberg. Welcome to the show, Lyle.
Hey, thanks very much. I'm really excited to be here.
No problem. So, Lyle, you're moving from the nitro fuel alter to a nitro funny car this year, right?
Actually, I'm moving from a blown alcohol altered to the nitro funny car. I've been running a blown alcohol altered for the last 5 years in the Western Fuel Altered circuit down here in the Southwest.
Ah, okay. And that was called the Cone Hunter too, right?
Yep, that was the Cone Hunter.
And the funny car is going to be called the Cone Hunter too?
Yes, it is. You know, we had so much great reviews from people about the name and the T-shirt that we had with the Altered that we didn't dare call it anything else.
Now, how did you come up with that name, Cone Hunter?
Well, you know, I'd always wanted to have a really cool T-shirt to sell at the races, but I figured nobody in the world would want to buy a T-shirt with my name and a picture of the car on it, because that sounds kind of boring. So I knew it had to have something cool on it. And I was watching the March meet on Bang Shift here a few years ago. And you know how they have that little chat thing on the side of it when you're watching it on the internet?
Right.
And some guy on the chat watched a fuel altered that had gone down the track and almost took out a cone. He says, "Man, that guy was out there hunting cones." And I thought, "Eureka, that's it, Cone Hunter." So we made a T-shirt out of it, sold a ton of them.
Good story. So now, what made you decide to move to nitro methane now?
Well, you know, I've been doing this for almost 45 years. This is going to be my 44th year of driving race cars, and I've been involved in it for even longer than that with my dad. And I've done a lot of stuff, raced a lot of cars, and the one thing I haven't done is a nitro car. And I'm not getting any younger, so I decided we better do it now.
Yeah, more expensive, though.
Oh, man. Yes, it is. We have spent a boatload of money, and I expected that. You know, that's not a real surprise to me. You know, I don't know how long we'll have the staying power to do a nitro car, but at least somewhere down the road, what is it the Harley ad says on TV? 10 years from now, you'll regret the things you didn't do a lot more than the things you did do. I don't want to regret not doing it.
Yeah, some of the drivers have been telling me the price of nitro methane is going up now.
It is. Actually, I've been pricing fuel and buying some. And, you know, when I first started pricing it here recently, it was about $1,000 a barrel. And now it's like $1,250, $1,300 a barrel.
Wow. So now, Lyle, how is the drag racing scene out in New Mexico?
You know, it's pretty good. We've got a track here in Albuquerque. This track here has been running since 1963. And, you know, it's a great place to go race. I've been racing there a long, long, long time. And it's home. It's not very far away. It's somewhat challenging to get a high horsepower car down. You know, we get good turnouts, and it's really a great place to go race.
Now, are there a lot of nitro methane funny cars out there?
No, you know, there's really only one other nitro car here in the whole state of New Mexico, and that's a guy by the name of Ray Stringer from down in Alamogordo who's got a steel Chevy on nitro, and between him and me, we will be the only nitro guys in the whole state.
Wow. So are you planning on going out of New Mexico at all this year?
Absolutely. Yeah, our plan right now is to test here in Albuquerque the middle of March. Then hopefully we're going to go somewhere, I don't know, maybe Tucson, Phoenix, Denver, something like that, do some more testing in April or May. And then the first real race we're going to run is Chris Graves' Funny Car Chaos, June 1st and 2nd in Amarillo.
Ah, that's a good event. You got all that mixture. You can bring anything over there, alcohol, nitro, whatever.
Yeah, you know, we thought it would be a really good thing for our deal because I'm actually not building a Heritage legal car. It's going to have a bigger fuel pump on it, and it's going to have an MSD 44-amp magneto on it. And so it's not a Heritage legal car, so I wouldn't be able to go run any of those races.
Yeah, I know the Funny Car Cast, they got four of them this year.
They do. And my plan is to at least run the Amarillo and the Denton, Texas race at North Star Dragway, because those are kind of both in my neighborhood. I don't think we'll make it to any of the others, but, frankly, if we test a couple of times and then go run two or three races or something like that, that'll probably blow my budget for the year anyhow.
Okay, so now you got started in drag racing by your father, you said?
I did. You know, my dad was, I like to say that he was the stereotypical hot rod hoodlum of the 50s. He was, he grew up in the 50s and loved hot rods and all that stuff. And he and a group of guys here in Albuquerque with the New Mexico Timing Association actually built the track here in Albuquerque in 1963. It's kind of funny. He used to tell a story that he'd go out there and dig fence post holes and stuff like that, and I'd run up and down the asphalt on my tricycle when I was like 3 years old.
So what was the first car your dad started driving in?
So he started out racing a 57, no, that, I'm wrong. Actually, he started out racing a 1960 Impala, and then a 57 Chevy, and then a 1960 Corvette. And then he was actually fairly well known down here in the Southwest back in the early 70s. He ran an Oldsmobile 442 W30 car in stock and super stock Eliminator.
So when did he retire from drag racing?
So, actually, he didn't retire. He just kind of retired from the scene. When I got my driver's license, he started allowing me to drive his Oldsmobile when I was 15 years old back in 1975. And I drove it in 75 and 76. And then I twisted his arm into selling it and buying a Comp Eliminator Dragster. We ran B Econo Dragster. And we ran that in 76 and 77. And then I went off and drove for other people, got a ride with a friend of mine, Andy Johnson, with his Van Crafter C Econo Altered, a Comp Eliminator car, and we ran that through 1980, even put a blown big block Chevy in it and ran double B Altered with it in Comp Eliminator. And I think my dad stopped racing in 1981, 82, something like that. But he stayed involved. He was an NHRA tech inspector here in Albuquerque, and then he sold racing fuel. And he'd always had an Amsoil synthetic oil dealership here, and he folded that into a whole lot of the racing stuff. He sponsored the track and stuff like that.
So the track that's out there now, is that a NHRA track?
It is, yep. It's an NHRA track, and actually they've been making great improvements to it, and I'm trying to remember here, a couple of years ago, I think they got the most improved track award from NHRA Division 7.
So now, when did the fuel altered, the Cone Hunter, come into play for you?
That car in, we started that the end of 2011 and started running it in 2012. I'd actually kind of taken about 10 years off of my own racing from 2004 through 2013 and really did nothing but help my girls race. My daughters, Jennifer and Rachel, both raced during that time frame. They had gone racing in quarter midgets, and then we had a split approach. We had Jennifer racing oval track stuff and Rachel running drag race stuff, and that kept me really, really, really busy. And it wasn't until 2012 that we put the Altered together and I started racing again.
So are your daughters still involved in drag racing at all?
You know, they're still helping me, but my oldest daughter, Jennifer, really had a pretty cool deal going with the oval track stuff. She went through quarter midgets and mini sprints, and then we fielded a USAC midget and ran with the Rocky Mountain Midget Association in Colorado and Kansas. And then she ended up getting a ride in a NASCAR support series out on the West Coast. And that lasted until 2008. And, of course, then the recession in 2008 hit, and we lost all the funding that we put together for that and went back and ran the midget for another year in 2009. And that was the end of her deal. She decided to get serious about college and got her college degree and that sort of thing, and kind of stopped driving race cars, just helped me and helped her sister. And her sister Rachel went through the junior dragsters and then into a big dragster. She had an undercover four lane car that we ran in Super Comp and Top Dragster, and she ran that through 2013. And then kind of did the same thing. You know, at some point they realized that they have to go out and get real jobs and do real adult things. And so they both concentrated on college and got college degrees. And I'm real proud of them for that.
So then you said 2012, the Cone Hunter was built.
2012.
Yeah.
Yeah, we didn't actually come up with the Cone Hunter name though until the beginning of 2016.
So now with that fuel alternator, what was the quickest pass you made with that car?
So we ran with the Western Fuel Altered Circuit, and they had some, you know, they were trying to restrict the cars and make it affordable to race. So there were, you know, pretty serious overdrive restrictions and stuff like that. We set the ET record for the Western Fuel Altereds for the first time in 2012 at a 658, and then in like 2014, I think we lowered it to a 653, and then in 2015, we lowered it to a 638, and that was the quickest that car went, and actually, that's still the ET record with WFA today.
Now, are there a lot of fuel altereds out in New Mexico?
No, I'm the only one.
Okay. Now, what happened with that car? Now, you still have that one?
No, I sold it last year, the beginning of last year. I sold it to Shane Blanton over in Texas, and that car is just a great looking car. They repainted it, and they run it with the Southwest Heritage Racing Association. So it's a 450 index. They run 8th mile stuff over there. He's got a supercharged big block Chevy in it that runs, I think, you know, mid fours. Great looking car, and I'm really glad that car is still out there racing.
Yeah, that's good to hear. Now, your dad was a big inspiration to you. Was there any other drag racers that been a big inspiration to you growing up?
Absolutely, yeah. You know, that's when I was growing up, when I was a little kid, that's all I wanted to think about was racing. I lived it, eat it, ate it, breathe it, you name it. I used to go watch the races with him when I could only watch, and then when I finally got old enough to where I could actually help, or at least try to help, I was always getting my hands dirty with him and stuff. And yeah, I mean, it was that was what I wanted to do.
So which guys that were out there back then would you say, I want to be like him?
Oh, that would have to be a guy named Bob Cavioni. So here in Albuquerque in New Mexico, kind of no different back then as it is now. There weren't a lot of nitro cars or anything like that. And Bob Cavioni and Lyle Dill were kind of the local nitro guys. They had front engine top fuel cars back through the 60s. On into the early 70s, 70 and 71. And I grew up thinking I wanted to drive top fuel dragsters just like my idol Bob Cavioni.
All right. So with you and the other guy being the only two nitro funny cars, the fans must really love it out there. I'm going to see you guys run.
Well, we're hoping. You know, since my car's not really hit the track yet or anything, we haven't done anything together, but Ray and I have certainly talked a lot about trying to get ourselves maybe booked in here in Albuquerque or, you know, any other tracks here in the Southwest. El Paso's got a great track. You know, we'd love to do some match races with the two of us, but I'm a big believer, and I don't go out and try to sell anything I know I can't do. And until I've got the car actually up and running, I haven't really made the approach to anybody on that yet.
Do any cars come in from out of state over there?
we get some. I mean, there's a great core of cars here in Albuquerque and Santa Fe, and then we get cars from northern New Mexico and southern New Mexico and El Paso. There's actually a great group of cars here called the Real Outlaw Door Slammers. They're kind of like pro mods and top sportsmen and stuff like that. And they run here several times a year, and boy, there's sure some great cars that run with that. Some blown alcohol cars, some turbo cars, some nitrous cars, and they put on a great show. And like you were just saying, Ray and I are hoping someday they'll allow us to come in and see if we can put a big show on too. I know one of the things that I decided to do when I decided to build the big pump car. So when I say big pump, the fuel pump on my car is going to be 34 gallons a minute, whereas all the Heritage Legal cars are at 21 gallons a minute. And one of the nice byproducts of that is at night it should make some great flames.
Yeah, you want some big header flames.
That's what we want to see, big header flames.
Give the fans a show, entertain them.
Yep.
Are you looking to do some long, smoky burnouts?
Well, we'll sure try. The tires these days, sometimes it's kind of hard to make a long, smoky burnout, but I actually had a pretty good reputation with the Altered. If you go out and look at any of our videos on the internet, there's a few videos out there that where I made some half trackers for sure. The crowd loves it.
Yeah, we got a couple of Nitro Funny cars out here. They got the big header flame, which is one driver named Joe Haas and John Lawson. One's the runaway, and the other one's I can't remember the name right now. But John Lawson built the cars. He put the big header flames on them. So
I've watched some of their videos, and those things are awesome. Those guys are running even bigger pumps. They're running like 60, 65 gallon a minute pumps, something like that. But man, those guys put on a show. Them and the Drastic Plastic Fuel Altered. Those are impressive.
Oh yeah, Tom Mochi's car. Tom Mochi and the Drastic Plastic.
Yep, pretty impressive cars.
Yeah, those are some big header flames. So what was it like to get behind the wheel for the first time of the fuel altered car?
You know, it was really a lot of fun. It wasn't a huge deal. I actually ran a big show, Top Alcohol Funny Car, back in the late 90s and early 2000s. And so, you know, back then they weren't as quick as they are now, but I had done 580s at 245-ish. And so when I got in the Altered, it was actually kind of like getting back in an alcohol funny car. Although I have to say the vision in the Altered was a lot worse. The car that I ended up with had a fairly low cage in the thing. You sat fairly low in the car, and then I put a big old carbon fiber injector hat on the thing, and geez, the top of the hat was about 4 or 5 inches above the top of my head. So the vision was a little limited, and that was always interesting.
Oh yeah, quick trial with the other car. I couldn't remember the name of it. That's the one Joe Haas drives. The quick draw and the I couldn't remember the name of the other car that Joe Haas drives. It's the quick draw. Now I remember.
Quick draw. Yeah, that's it.
Yeah, you got the orange one. You got the green one. They always do match racing together. So now, Lyle, when you take this funny car, how many crew members are you looking to have for the car?
Oh, you know, we will hope to have at least 4 or 5. You know, it's always tough to get enough crew together. I've got a really great core group of guys that help me. And it always depends on how much traveling you do and everything, because you really can't ask them all to take a lot of time off of work all the time. I've got a real great core group of people. In fact, if you'll allow me, I'd like to give them some props, because they've been with me through thick and thin, and that's Butch Blackburg and Rick Schumann, Sean Guthrie, my daughter Jennifer Guthrie, my grandson Connor Guthrie. Rachel Greenberg, Chris and Tiffany Stinson, Russ Marr, Chris Schumann, AJ Ortiz, Mike LeBate, Alan Skinner, and the Johnson brothers. Between all those guys, we always manage to get four or five people who can go with us to every race.
Yeah, and of course, this is going to be a lot more work with the nitromethane after each run, doing all the changing spark plugs and all that stuff.
Yeah, you know, we have this fantasy. I don't know if it's really true or not, but we have this fantasy that you know, when we're at least match racing the car or something like that, hopefully we don't have to pull the heads off every run. We know we'll probably have to pull them off every now and then and stuff. But you know, that's one of the things about the heritage cars. Those guys running those cars so hard that the heads are off and the full rack of pistons is out and a whole new rack goes into it. And you're right, it's a ton of work and you need a lot of folks. You know, I went to three heritage races last year and watched some of those crews, and my gosh, some of those guys have seven or eight guys with them.
Yeah. Yeah, it'll be quite a change for you to run the nitromethane.
It will. And I don't have any experience with nitro at all. And so fortunately I've got myself hooked up with Jake Sanders. Jake is the crew chief for his dad, Mark Sanders, on the Mr. Explosive Heritage funny car, the Nitro Nostalgia funny car. And Jake has really been kind of guiding me and helping me figure out what I need to buy. And actually, I had the car back in his shop for several months here towards the end of last year. He was doing a whole bunch of work on it for me, and I'll actually be flying him in to tune the car, at least for the first few races, just to help me understand what I need to be doing.
Now, what kind of car is that, funny car?
It's a 78 Corvette body, so if people remember the bodies like Tom McEwen had on his car back in the late 70s, it's a body like that.
Oh yeah, the Mongoose. Yeah, I remember the gray one he had.
Yep, and that's exactly the body style that this car is.
Now, do you have any sponsors there for this car?
Oh man, we try to get as much sponsor help as we can. You know, we don't have any big sponsors, but we get lots of help from people. You know, my family owns an Amsoil dealership here in Albuquerque, All American Lubricants, and so I get lots of help from my family. Cabinet Concepts of New Mexico, Sunco Equipment and Supply, High Mesa Frames, Homes by LeBate, Car Crafters, WJR Photography, Water Jet Cutting, Rhino Board, Synergy Coatings, Stinson Metal Fab, and DJ Safety's been giving us some help here recently too.
So you get your fire suit from DJ Safety?
No, you know, I already had a suit, but my blower bag came from them, and the transmission blanket came from them, and Big Ben Conant there at DJ, he's been a huge help.
Now, this next question, I can't ask you about the funny cars since you haven't driven yet, but for the Fialtered, what do you had, like, weekend at drag racing? What went into preparation of getting that thing ready for a weekend?
I'm sorry, say that again?
I was saying I can't ask you about the funny car yet since you haven't driven it, but for the Fialtered, for when you got ready for a weekend of drag racing, what went into preparation for getting that car ready?
Well, you know, I think it'll probably be the same as it's going to be with the Nitro car, too. You know, the car has to come completely apart between events and look everything over and replace what needs to be replaced and get all ready for that and make sure you got all your spare parts ready to go. And, of course, driving-wise, just make sure you got your head on straight and go out there and do what you need to do to get the car from A to B without tearing anything up, if you can help it.
Now, with the Fialtered, did you run anywhere out of New Mexico?
Oh, yeah. That Western Fialtered circuit would run in Tucson, Phoenix, Las Vegas. Sometimes they were going to Barona, California. You know, primarily we ran the Arizona, Nevada, and New Mexico races.
So what were some of your favorite tracks to run on?
Well, you know, know, you always have to love going to Las Vegas just because it's such a fabulous facility. And the track is, you know, it's always really good there when it's national events. A couple times that we were there when we were there just with the WFA show, you know, the track wasn't probably quite as good as a national event, but it was pretty darn good. But I got to say, probably my favorite track of all of them, well, my home track here in Albuquerque is my favorite because I don't have to go very far to get there. But my favorite track of everything else is probably Tucson. Love that track in Tucson.
So all the tracks you ran on were all quarter mile?
Yeah, you know, 44 years of driving race cars, and I've never run an eighth-mile race in my life. So that Funny Car Chaos race will kind of be the new thing for me.
Yeah. So throughout your drag racing career, have you ever had any accidents or near accidents?
You know, I had a pretty big fire with the top alcohol funny car back in 1998 over at Phoenix at Firebird, or what they call Wild Horse Pass now. Had a pretty big fire there. Haven't ever, knock on wood, haven't ever really hit anything solid other than a cone or two. You know, when I was doing some circle track stuff, I ran some sprint car stuff, and you know, we'd knock a corner off the car, or knock the front end off the car, or something like that in a little minor skirmish. But knock on wood, never had any really big accidents.
Well, you are the cone hunter, Lyle.
Absolutely, that's why I threw that in there, because it's a fact. I've taken out a cone or two in my day.
Yeah. Now, you ready for some fun questions? If someone were to give you $150 million and say, Lyle, build me a drag race track, where would you build the track, and what kind of features would you want to put into the track?
Where would I build it? Well, you know, obviously I'd have to say I'd probably build it here in New Mexico, because if I had $150 million, I guess I wouldn't care if it made money or not, and I'd want it to be in my backyard, but I'd build it in the middle of nowhere so that hopefully it doesn't get shut down by any development or anything like that. You know, I always think about these guys that talk about building the track over in the Lake Havasu, Arizona area, and that always seems like a great idea to me, to just put it out in the middle of the desert somewhere, as long as you don't try to run in June, July, and August, I guess. What kind of features? Well, I mean, I love all kinds of racing. I actually race a vintage Formula Ford road race car, too. So if I had that much money and I was going to build a track, it would have a road race course, and it would have a dirt track, and it would have a drag strip.
Okay. Now, Lyle, do you have any hobbies outside of drag racing?
Not really. Seems like that one's more than enough.
Now, if you were able to do time travel and go back in time, would you do anything differently?
Absolutely. Man, if I could go back in time and make it so that I was about 25 years old in 1966, I just know I'd have figured out a way to drive top fuel cars back in the 60s and 70s, back when you could actually do it without being a zillionaire.
Yeah. Yeah, my dad started taking me to drag race when I was like 4 or 5, and they had the big funny car fuels, the like 20, 30 cars back then. It was, you know, that was old, good old days.
Well, they were, but, you know, the thing is, you know, we got what we got today, and actually there's a saying that I always try to remember, and that is, we're living the good old days right now, because somewhere down the road people look back at this and say, this was the good old days.
Yeah, but back in the old days, it was more, you know, you had all the long smoky burnouts and the dry hopping with the funny cars, like the Snake and Mongoose and everybody.
Yeah. Absolutely. I mean, like I say, I would love to have done that back then. I'm a huge trivia nut. I have a lot of friends here who make fun of me because pretty much a lot of stuff that people talk about on Facebook or the internet or something like that, I know a lot of stuff about drag race history and drag race trivia, because that's what I live and breathe.
Now, do you ever take vacations at all, Kyle? To Lyle, I mean?
Do I ever what?
You ever go on vacations at all?
You know, every now and then I do, but, you know, the race trips are far more than the vacation trips. You know, I usually try to take one vacation a year somewhere. I mean, like last year, my wife and I took my grandson, who was 3. We took him camping, and I say camping with air quotes because we took my toter home it's like an RV, and we went up to Southern Colorado and spent a week camping up there, and so that was a vacation for sure.
So Southern Colorado would be your favorite vacation spot?
Absolutely. My wife and I love to go to Durango and Pagosa Springs, great places.
Okay, so what's your favorite food?
Well, I'm from New Mexico, so I guess it would be against our religion here to say anything other than New Mexican food. I love New Mexican food, and we're pretty snobby about our food here because it's really different than Mexican food, and it's really different than Tex-Mex. The New Mexican is its own little deal. You know, it's kind of a blend of the Indian culture and the Hispanic culture, and boy, no place has Mexican food like we do.
What's your favorite beverage of choice?
Iced tea.
Do you drink alcohol?
Rarely. You know, I will socially every now and then, but if there's liquor in the house, it tends to stick around a long time.
So if you do drink, what do you drink?
Margaritas.
Okay. Favorite music?
Classic rock and roll from the 70s. Everybody that travels with me is sick to death of listening to Lyle's favorite road songs, volumes 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. That has everything from the 70s.
No. Now, do you have a favorite movie of all time?
A favorite what?
A favorite movie of all time.
Oh, favorite movie of all time. You know, I'm not much of a moviegoer, so I guess the answer is no, I really don't.
Not even when you were younger, you didn't have a favorite movie?
No, not really. You know, here's a true story. When I was a teenager in high school, I was racing, which meant that I worked on race cars at night and on weekends, and we went racing all the time, and I really didn't do much else.
So do you watch TV at all?
Yeah, you know, I watch some of the Cloak and Dagger show, not Cloak and Dagger, but crime shows, I guess. You know, I like Criminal Minds and The Blacklist and NCIS.
Okay, now when you're racing at the track, do you eat any food, or do you eat lightly, or don't eat at all?
My kids tell me that I forget to eat too much because you get all wound up and get all focused on stuff and you sometimes just kind of forget to eat. But one of the fabulous things that I feel so blessed at is my daughters, Jennifer and Rachel, you know, they'll usually cook at the track. We'll usually have a barbecue set up or crock pots or something like that to feed all the crew. And they do a great job of feeding us.
Now, if you weren't drag racing, what do you think you'd be doing?
I guess I'd be doing some other kind of racing.
Probably circle track.
Yeah, maybe circle track. You know, this vintage road race car I have is a real hoot to drive. It's not super duper fast, and it doesn't make a lot of power, but it corners like stink. And it's a lot of fun to drive. I wish I had more time to race it too, but you know, we race that 3 or 4 times a year, and that seems like all I can manage.
Now, for the funny car, do you have your license yet?
I don't. You know, I did a really stupid thing several years ago. I let my top alcohol funny car license lapse back when my girls were racing because I guess I didn't think I'd be doing anything like this again. So, yeah, I have to do a 3-run upgrade. I got to do a moderate run and 2 full pulls. And And, you know, we'll see how hard that's going to be. That could be a challenge in Albuquerque, so that may have to wait until we go someplace like Tucson or Phoenix or something.
No, the car, you already have the car with you? You keep it where you had at home?
Oh, yeah, yeah. So I actually went back to Indianapolis here 2.5 weeks ago to Jake Sanders' shop. he kind of jokingly calls it his Funny Car Fun Factory. And we picked it up, and actually while I was back there, we fired it on 91% nitro and tackled it there in the driveway of his shop, and that was cool as heck. And then we loaded it all up in the trailer, and I brought it home, and actually 2 days after I got home, I delivered the body to the paint shop. It's over at Car Crafters right now to get the paint scheme applied to it, and as soon as we get the body back, you know, either later this month or early in March, we're going to try to go hit the gas here in Albuquerque in the middle of March.
No, have you ever sat in the car yet and put the body down yet?
Oh yeah, oh yeah. It's like being home again. There's a guy there in the Midwest that I always love to see his comments. Randy Baker, who always used to call the funny car drivers quick cave dwellers, because the body was like being in a cave. And I hadn't been in a funny car since 2003, I guess, was the last time I was in a funny car. But when we put the body down and everything, it was just like being home again.
Yeah. No, no claustrophobia when you in 2003 when you first put a body down?
Oh no, I love little tight spaces. So yeah, no claustrophobia here.
All right. So throughout your drag racing career, what have been the milestones, Lyle?
Oh man, you know, I'm getting so old. Sometimes it's hard to remember all of them. But you know, I've been blessed with a lot of success and a lot of fun stuff. You know, I always joke that the first race I ever ran was in late 1974 after I first got my driver's license. And it was a bracket race back when bracket racing was really a new thing. And I went out there driving my mom's daily driver, a little Nova with a 283 and a power glide. And it went consistent 20-20s. It was a speed demon, 20-20s. And I went out there for a bracket race, and I won the whole shooting match. And that was probably one of the craziest things to ever do, because talk about getting the bug and being addicted. I was addicted from that point forward. But, yeah, you know, some of the milestones, in 75, the Police Athletic League here in Albuquerque had a high school program to try to get the kids off the streets so they didn't street race and stuff. And I won the season championship with that, which was really cool because I got a college scholarship out of that deal. And I'm probably one of the few people who can legitimately say they put themselves through college on racing. Between that college scholarship and some money that I was making while I was bracket racing and stuff like that while I was going to college, a whole heck of a lot of my college got paid for by racing. So that was really a cool deal.
So now, which one of those events would you consider your fondest memory then, the first one?
Yes, I don't know. I sure remember it real well, that's for sure. I mean, we had all sorts of other cool stuff. I mean, back when I was running my dad's Oldsmobile, we had a lot of success here regionally here in Albuquerque and Roswell. Won a lot of stock, super stock combo races. And when we had the Comp Eliminator Dragster, we won a big race down in El Paso called the Southwest Championships. It had a lot of Texas and Arizona and New Mexico Comp Eliminator cars, and got runner-up at the High Altitude Nationals in 76 up in Pueblo. Yeah, you know, a lot of cool stuff. I mean, I probably had most of my success, certainly not with the Top Alcohol Funny Car. I mean, I was way outgunned on that deal. I used to joke with the Alcohol Funny Car that the guys we were racing against, you know, the Pat Austins and the Bucky Austins and all those guys usually had more spare motors than we had spare pistons. But it was kind of something I always wanted to do, and that was a fun deal. But honestly, some of the best memories and some of the best successes were the racing I did with my girls. Like I said, both my girls, Jennifer and Rachel, they were both kick-ass race car drivers, and we won a ton of races. I think in the 3 years Rachel did junior dragster, she won like 16 or 17 races and season championship and all sorts of stuff. And my daughter Jennifer won the season championship in a sprint car deal and rookie of the year in the midgets up in Rocky Mountain Midget Association. So, yeah, I've been really blessed. Lots of cool stuff.
So a lot of trophies at the house?
Yeah, we got more trophies than we know where to put them. I actually bought a trophy case here, oh, I don't know, 7 or 8 years ago and put it in the living room, and it got filled up just with stuff we already had around, and now when we get new trophies, I have to cycle the old ones out, and I've got trophies down at the Amsoil shop, and yeah, one of these days I think I'm going to have to just start giving them away, recycling back to the junior dragster kids.
Yeah. So in New Mexico, how's the junior dragster scene over there?
You know, it's really pretty good. The typical bracket race here in Albuquerque, I think they usually have between 10 and 15 junior dragsters. And, you know, that probably doesn't sound like a ton to the people who might be in Southern California or the Chicago area or something like that, but you know, in little old New Mexico, where we only have about 1.5 million people total in the state, and only about 700,000 in the Albuquerque metro area, it sure seems like that's a pretty good turnout.
So how important do you think it is for the kids to go out to see drag racing?
Oh, man, the junior dragster thing, it's so important. I mean, you know, one of my regrets, I guess, honestly, is that they didn't have something like that when I was a kid. Because, man, I would have been all over that junior dragster thing. But, you know, after doing the quarter midgets with both my girls on the oval track side, and then the junior dragster with Rachel, when Rachel came out of that junior dragster and got into the super comp car, I mean, she was pretty immediately competitive in Super Pro, in the bracket racing around here. In fact, she won a Super Pro race, I think, 4 months after she started driving the dragster. She was like 16 years and 4 months old or something like that. And I'm sure it's because of the skills she developed when she was racing the junior dragster.
That's good. Now, if people are listening right now and they want to, like, see where you're going to be racing at, what's the best way for them to find it, like, online or... Yep.
So I'm pretty active on Facebook. Either friend me on Facebook under my name, Lyle Greenberg, or we actually have a Cone Hunter Racing Facebook page. Certainly like us on Cone Hunter Racing. I also have a website, conehunter.net. I have Twitter and I have Instagram, but honestly, it's all I can do to keep track of the Facebook stuff. I'm too old to do all that stuff.
Yeah, you have to let the daughters handle those.
Yeah, you know, I don't even know if they have time for that. Yeah, you know, I probably spend way too much time on Facebook as it is. So, you know, you talked about, do I have any hobbies? Yeah, I guess I do have one hobby, and that's, there's a Facebook page called The History of Albuquerque Drag Racing, and it's just so cool because it's got all the pictures of cars I remember from when I was a kid and when I was an adult and when I was a teenager, and I spend a lot of time on there helping people identify cars and looking at the pictures and remembering all the good times. So that, I guess that's kind of a hobby. It's still a racing hobby, but it's a hobby.
Yeah. So far you just got the one event confirmed so far, the Funny Car Chaos?
Yeah, you know, I that's the only one that I'm confirmed on. Certainly I have every intention of running the last Funny Car Chaos of the year, which is the one at North Star Dragway in Denton, Texas. I haven't entered it yet. I don't even know if the entries are open for that race. It's not till September. Yeah, the Funny Car Chaos in Amarillo, June 1st and 2nd, that's the only one for sure on my schedule. You know, I hope we'll be able to maybe run the car sometime during the summer. I don't know, maybe in Albuquerque or El Paso, or there's no telling where. Wherever they might throw a buck or two my way.
Okay, sounds good, Lyle. I want to thank you for your time for doing an interview tonight.
Great. Well, thank you. I appreciate it.
Okay. We'll do another interview in the future when you get the car running later down the road.
Sounds good. I'd enjoy that.
Okay. You have a good night, Lyle.
Thank you. You too. Good night.
Good night. Bye-bye.